Hello and welcome to Grand Canyon National Park. My name is Ranger Jabez. Today I'm out here standing at Pima Point. Have you ever wondered how the Grand Canyon was formed and why it's found here in northern Arizona? These are some commonly asked questions that we get from visitors. To understand the formation of the canyon, there is a simple way to sum up how it's shaped over time. All you have to remember are the letters D-U-D-E or DUDE. The first letter stands for deposition. The Earth is made up of igneous, metamorphic, and sedimentary rocks. Here at the Grand Canyon, the majority of rocks are sedimentary. If you look into the canyon, you can see the different layers of rocks. Over hundreds of millions of years, different types of sediments were deposited to make the collections of layers that we see today. Each of these layers tells us a story of the environment that existed when they formed. Some are made up of oceanic sediment when this area was covered by a shallow sea, while others reflected a drier climate characterized by windswept sand dunes. These differing conditions give the rocks their unique layer cake look. Most of this deposition occurred around sea level, but I'm not underwater or anywhere near a sea. In fact, the south end of the Grand Canyon, where I'm standing, is 7,000 feet above sea level, which brings us now to the next letter. U stands for uplift, which helps account for Grand Canyon's elevation. 50 to 70 million years ago, the Earth's tectonic plates began to shift, causing this uplift. Two plates collided, which forced one underneath the other, pushing this area up in a flat, uniform fashion, creating the Colorado Plateau. Most of the time, plates collide in a more violent meaning, creating valleys or mountains. But the relatively calm uplift in this area kept those rock layers from our first step in place. Now with the region high and flat, the stage is set for our next letter in our process. The second D is for downcutting. This process began about 5 to 6 million years ago when the Colorado River began to flow its current course. You might wonder how that tiny river that you see from the rim helped carve this massive canyon. Water is more forceful when it has a steeper slope. The Colorado River starts around 14,000 feet in elevation and dropped about 7 feet per mile over its course. As it flows, it carries with it a large amount of debris that acts as liquid sandpaper as it moves across the relatively soft sedimentary rocks of the canyon. This explains the deep cut that helped to create the canyon. However, other forces contributed to make it so grand, which takes us to our last letter. The E stands for erosion. With the river downcutting, other forces helped in the shaping of the side of the canyon. Water was still a factor, but in the forms of rainfall, ice wedging, and snowmelt. Ice wedging is when water freezes and thaws in the cracks of the canyon. This type of erosion occurs here because of the huge temperature swings that we get throughout the year. During the day, it can be warm, but at night, the temperatures can drop below freezing. Water freezes and thaws in the cracks of the rocks, causing them to break apart from the sides of the canyon and fall to the bottom. Other types of erosion occur from snowmelt and rainfall. There are two wet seasons here at the canyon. One is in the winter when it snows, and the other is monsoon season during the summer months. The north rim gets more snow and rainfall than the south rim based on the difference in elevation. It's about 1,000 feet higher. When the snow melts or when the rain falls on the south rim, it tends to flow away from the canyon. On the north rim, it tends to flow into the canyon. Because of this, the walls on the north rim are eroding further away from the river. Thanks to water's contribution to the forces of erosion, we can enjoy this grand sight and marvel in its glory. We want to thank you for watching, and we hope one day you can come visit Grand Canyon National Park. And if you do, remember D-U-D-E or DUDE.